Praise Lord.
Hello, brother. Good evening.
Good evening, brother. Praise Lord.
Yeah, brother. Praise the Lord. How are you?
Yeah, I'm fine. I hope everyone is doing good. Everyone is fine.
Yeah, brother.
Really, it's a great joy and privilege. And I request everyone to share this link to the people so that they may hear the word of God with us and will be blessed. As God is very near to us, the God of the Bible who speaks with us very closely. And as we are going to listen His word, let us make our hearts so that pray to God like, Lord, I want to listen Your word so that I may absorb it and I may grasp everything that You speak to me, and it will be useful for me, Lord. Look to the Lord. We'll look to the Lord in prayer, and then we'll go for the meditation of the word of God. Shall we all look to the Lord in prayer, that so that our hearts may be turned towards God?
Yes.
Father, we submit this precious time into Your mighty hands. Lord, we believe that You are the God who do in the midst of us, Lord Father. Whatever we are going through, Lord Father, You are going to be helping us. And Lord Father, thank You so much for everything that You have done in our lives. And Lord Father, we bless this ministry, the people who are coming live and the people who are going to come in the live, Lord Father. Let us have a heart of hearing Your word, and so that, Lord Father, we may have hearing in a great way, Lord Father, so that it may be useful in our lives. And whatever we hear, Lord Father, whatever we heard from Your word of God, Lord Father, so that we may not deceive ourselves, as James says, Lord Father, we should be the doers of the word. Give us the heart and transform life so that we may worship You through our deeds each and every time that we are in this world, each and every second that we are spending in this world. Thank You so much for the hope and salvation that You had given. The rest of the time we submit into Your mighty hands, in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Really, God bless us, and this is great, really a great joy and privilege to join each and everyone. As we are going to go into the meditation of Word of God, I really have a few questions. Many people have seen this topic name, He is the rock under my feet. What is the symbolic form that rock has in the word of God? Why did the Old Testament most of the time talks about the rock? Why is that rock of salvation? Why is it the cornerstone? Or else, why is it all about the rock when it talks about God? And why is it? Most of the time, when we look to the Lord, when we look to the word of God, we see it was symbolizing Lord's foreverness and our way of having the firm, strong belief in Him, and how much dependable God is and how righteous God is. All these things come under the simple thing that God has spoken, like He is the rock of salvation. In Deuteronomy, we'll see in 32 chapter, Moses is speaking to the people, and he speaks about the rock of salvation. He speaks about the rock that God, how faithful He has been. My dear friends, today's topic, you can see this, He is the rock under my feet. And let's look to the Lord. So Lord, we'll meditate on Your word. And I have a small introduction for this sermon. Let's go to the sermon now. I used to study in Bangalore, and I used to travel from there each Saturday. I used to go to a church very far from my college. I used to travel, and the way is such a beautiful scenery it has, and every time when I travel, I used to see the mountains, and especially when I go near to that place where I have to reach, I see a huge rock on the mountain. It was very huge. I was very observant guy, so I was watching at that and thinking, Lord, how in the world that rock is left there? And if that rock moves down, there is nothing. Accident could happen. All the village that was downstairs could downside can get into a problem. It's a really a danger. And I reached the pastor, and I asked him. He from the childhood he was there, so I asked him, Pastor, why is that rock was left on the top of the mountain? It is very huge. Something could happen, and it could come down. And he said, like, because you're watching the rock from a long distance, very long distance, you see it. It's very small. From my childhood, we have the same question, and we travel to the place where the rock is there. So we used to go there, and we both brothers used to push that rock. You know how big it is? It's bigger than our house, and it looks very small from the far. But see, so how much energy we just push it, it is not moving, not even an off an inch or else in millimeter. And he said, like, that is how the God's creation is called rock is not moving. Look at that, when the word of God says he is the rock of our salvation. And this is really, really a good thing that we could reflect on. And today, I really want to give some reflections on the particular situation. And so that we may speak to people, we may encourage each other with the word of God. And it will be really a great blessing for us. Coming to the sermon, what we are going to listen today, and we are going to reflect on what is the rock? Where am I standing? As a Christian, where is my foundation? Where am I standing? Is my foundation, is my rock of salvation, is trustworthy? Is he movable or else not movable? He is, I can depend upon him or not. This and all comes under whatever we are speaking right now. And on January 11, 2020, the first death of COVID-19 happened. My dear friends, you never imagine this thing could happen. There in the one country it started, and it started spreading all over the world, and all the people were suffering now. They don't know what to do. And all the presidents who has been greatly welcomed all over the countries, all over the world, were being very frightened. They don't know what to do. They don't have hope to depend upon. And people were giving up. They're giving up whatever they have. Many people were dying without food because of this quarantine. And many people were suffering a lot. What does it mean to me as a Christian now? What does it mean to me as I reflect on this particular situation? Is what today what we are going to meditate on. See, whatever it may be, this is the time when the fragile form of the world is felt. We can see how fragile human life is, how fragile our industrial things, how fragile we think about money, or else someone is sending invitation. Okay. See how fragile the world is all about, and look to that. Just think about this. Once upon a time, we used to think, I should complete this task. And people like me, I like traveling. So I used to plan, like, I used to go with my cousins out, and I have to go to far places, and we should go and we praise God, we should enjoy. And I have a lot of plans, and we have plans to go, write exams, finish it happily. Many people who are in life, I think you have felt like me. I felt very sad when I left my college and I didn't write my annual exams. I feel like I don't complete this year, or else I'm not feeling happy really. But the joy of the Lord is always with us, and I started meditating on word, and I'm really enjoying each and every day. We have a group called Bible study, and we are doing a Bible study there. We meditate on the word. See, look at this. Whatever the situations what we are going through right now, it started at Jan 11, 2020, the first death of COVID-19. And whatever it may be, we can clearly see the fragile nature of the world, which we are in, the planet Earth, on the planet Earth. And for the people, seemingly the firm, the solid foundations are shaking. All that, all the stock markets have gone down. People were suffering really. All the rich people were thinking about where to invest their money right now. And all the poor people were thinking about, how we will get money to survive. And all these problems shows how fragile we are. And once upon a time, when pastor calls us, we used to say, like, I'm in office, I can't attend this meeting. I'm in office, so I can't come tomorrow. I'm in office, I have some other work, I can't come and help you for the church things. Or else, I'm in office, I can't attend the prayer. Or else, my friend has some work to do, so that's why he's not present for his own home prayer meeting. That was cottage meeting that happening inside the house, his own house. See, people, see, all these things with a simple virus, COVID-19, happened. It's not a simple thing for a human, because it's a fragile world. But for God, it is just a small organism that he created as a creator of the universe. And look to that, how fragile we are. And how fragile things happened, and how the world got down. I was shocked after 3 months coming here and looking at the situations, what we are going to do, what we are going through, and all the news that we are listening, how people were getting depressed, anxious about what happens tomorrow, what will be my schedule, and what will be my job opportunities for the next year, what will be my studies that we're going through. People, today one of my friend, he texted me from Tamil Nadu, and he's saying like the academic year was shifted to September. It could be because we are so fragile, we can't stand against something that happened in the world. But my dear friends, I praise God. The question we should ask today is, you know what? Do we have the rock under our feet? The rock that cannot be shaken forever. We should have a firm foundation, and where you and I are standing should have an everlasting result. This fragile world cannot contain us more than 80. What Moses says, if you are good enough, you will live to 80s. See, look at this, how fragile the world is. Just for a virus, world is suffering this much. And look to this, my dear friends, look to this and reflect on your mind. If this is so fragile, and I depend upon my educations, I depend upon my qualification I have, I depend upon something that I have back at home, I depend upon my riches I have. See, look at this, all the things. Someone is sending the fat house. And see, look at that. See, look at that. You look at everything that you have, every gadget you have, everything that you that belongs to us. Today, nothing is useful. You can't go out happily in your car. And you can't go out happily with your bike out and ride to places where you like to go. You can't go and have a drink now. See how fragile world become within a short time. Look at this. I really praise God for the hope and the faith that gives us hope in Christ, and the love of God that was poured upon us, so that so blessed we are. So blessed we are. See, look at this. I praise God. Our hope is not on playing odds. What I mean when I say odds is like people were saying now, temporarily we will only take these youth people who can survive this virus, and all the people who are the age above, old people, the grandpa and grandmother, all these grandmothers and grandfathers, they're leaving them for the treatment. Many people were thinking, if someone is not taking care of this and this, and we are playing odds, but this is not a firm foundation. We are not able to stand there. If you are quarantined for 2 years, are we going to live here? No, not at all. We can't survive. Really, we can't survive. And see, look at this. When we look into these situations, what we are going through, even if you play odds now, playing like you should not self-quarantine, or else you should not go out. We are trying our level best. Our government is trying their level best, playing odds. They're placing police in every junction, and they're not allowing us to go out. They're taking care of everything. But still then, the cases were increasing. Till then, we can't control the situation. Somewhat we can try our playing odds. We can somewhat. That is not firm foundation where we can stand. See, where we can stand, that is not the foundation where we can stand. And I really praise God, because our hope is in God. Our salvation, the rock of our salvation, is Jesus Christ alone. And He is giving an everlasting thought for us. And the Word of God says, the God in whom we have hope, He's saying in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 9 to 10, He's saying, for God did not permit us to suffer wrath, but to receive salvation through our Jesus Christ. He died for us so that whether we are awake or asleep, we may live together with Him. Look at this Bible verse. I want to read it again. Look at this. How wonderful this is. God did not appoint us to suffer wrath, but to receive salvation through Jesus Christ. He died, the Jesus Christ died for us, so that whether we are awake, whether we are alive today, or else asleep, whether you sleep, whether we are doing our work, or else whether the people, see, look at this, how fragile the world. Every time when I preach in some of the services, I used to say this word, because it catches a lot of attention from the people. Look at this, my dear friends. If I am Samuel Aditya, I've been only one son to my mother, and I have two siblings also. But still then, the respect they have and the love they have towards me is more, because I am one among them, and all the church people love me. And so, see, all the things, even my now the brothers who are coming live, and see, all people, they're saying like, okay, this guy is doing ministry, and this guy wanted to do for God's ministry, and all these things were very good. But if I die, are you going to call me with my name? Just reflect on this. If I am dead right now here in this place, are you going to say that Samuel Aditya raise up, or else Samuel Aditya, you are that guy Samuel Aditya? You will not say all this stuff. Come on, you just call me a dead body. The conclusion, how fragile we are, how fragile our movements, how fragile our thoughts about our own life. Look at this. Even my father can't ask carry Samuel Aditya to the otherwise outside the house. He will not say. At the moment I die, they look at me and mourn for some time, and they say like, take the body, otherwise it will smell. Look at this, my dear friends. How true is these things? How fragile we are in this world, and where we have to stand? Are we really standing there where we are going to do this work of God? And are we really depending upon Him? Are we trusting Him to the fullest? Are we really grieving Holy Spirit? Or else are we really praising Him in the midst of this quarantine? Or else are we praising Him more and more for who God is? Even if God is not doing great miracles in our midst right now, and He is doing great miracles through the testimonies of the people who are suffering there. And look at this, last few weeks back, people were testifying. I saw this in the news channel, and in Hindi news channel, one auntie was saying beautifully she testified God in the news channel. She said like, I know the people were trying odds, all the doctors were coming and treating me, all the nurses were coming and treating me, they're playing their odds, they're keeping protection, they're trying their level best to be with me, but my God had healed me to the fullest. What she said. Do you think that opposite guy is asking like, do you think these doctors were not working? And she said like, yes, they are trying their odds, they're trying their level best to do that, but my God is a miracle doing God, and He had healed me. He had helped me to come out of that depression, He had helped me to come out of that anxiety, He had helped me to come out of that place where I'm quarantined, anyone can touch me. Look at this, how beautiful our God is present each and every place where we are, and how close He was to our heart. My dear friends, our God is really praiseworthy. He deserves worship, He deserves glory. And even if you live and you die for Him, it's not enough to express your gratitude towards His grace and mercy, the gift that He had given through Jesus Christ. Look at this. Reflect. I want to read it again. He died for us so that whether we are awake or asleep, we may live together with Him. We may live together with Him. We are going to live with Him. He is God. He has done great things for us, and He will do great things for us. He is trustworthy. We will depend upon Him. He is trustworthy. We trust Him in any situation that comes in my life. Can we say with the faith, we can confess this, Lord, You are trustworthy. Lord, I can depend upon You. Lord, I know even in this particular situation, even if the 1 year got wasted in our lives, Lord Father, even this summer got wasted in our life, if we think with our human minds, but You are making us to go near You. You are making us to come near to Your feet. Lord, I know You are so great and so close, so lovable, so I can depend upon You. That is how we can express. That is how we can express, and we can say to Him. See, today when I was seeing the feed in Insta, I came across this quote. Stress comes from trying to do it all on our own. I want to read it again. Stress comes from trying to do all on our own. And the next two lines, it comes like, peace comes from putting it all in God's hands. I want to read it again. Peace comes from putting it all in God's hand. What is this submission? Someone wrote this quote. No, there is no one who had quoted at the end. But look at this. look at this. They're trying to express something from their heart. So they may going through a tough time, like anxiety issues. Otherwise they were going to stress situation, feeling alone, depressed, deep inside their heart, and they're feeling like, I can't meet my friends, I can't go out, I can't have my coffee which I'd like to have, or else I can't meet my friend whom I really like to talk, and I'm missing my church too much. I miss my friends playing together with them and jam the instruments, and I miss that time. You could have felt like that, or else you miss like. We'll discuss about this deep inside. And see, this thought, stress comes from trying to do it on your own. See, they're trying to express like, if I try to do everything by my own, see, they're saying, I feel very stressed. And the second line they're trying to express is like, peace comes from, see, look at this, my dear friends, they're trying to do it. They're saying that stress comes from trying to do it by my own. Peace comes from putting it all in God's hands. See, we submit to the hands of God and we submit everything now. Thank you so much for reacting. Thank you so much for saying that. And look at this. How God, I'm getting noise from some other device, I think so, from your place. Yeah. Look at this. Yeah, okay. See, even if you put the trust in God and you place everything, many people try to do this thing, and many people says like, whether we do like to depend upon God. People depend too much on God, and too much they go for extreme. They think like God is going to take everything else. See, my dear friends, this quote is incomplete actually. Peace comes from putting it all in our God's hand. Yes, peace comes when you submit to a God, and when you are not stressed out, when you keep the everything that you belongs to God, you're going to see that God is doing, God is working in your life. But it doesn't mean that you will be out of the picture wherever you are. It doesn't mean that you will be out of the picture. You are not out of the picture, my dear friends. So look, can we look to this? See, we just meditating on the word of God, and we came across how firm how firm the God's salvation in our hands now. How can we express God in our life? How can we go near Him, and how we can express our gratitude in these times of feeling alone? My dear friends, today when I'm preparing this sermon, I was praying to Lord, help me to make this word to understand. I know how graceful, how lovable you are, how close to heart you are for us. And God is speaking to me. I felt like the inner voice is speaking to me, and I felt very happy. Listen to these words. This came like God is helping me to understand, because what we are going to meditate today is Matthew 7, a part of Sermon on the Mount, and a part of Sermon on the Mount, and the coming chapter, it has a wonderful thing that many of the songs were written, and many songs were written on that. See, but remember, if God is the one to say, to put the boat inside the ocean or sea, He is the one who is going to bring you out of the storm. If God is the one asking you to go live on the planet Earth, an example for us, for me, and worship me all through the days you live there, my dear friends, the God is the one who is going to give us salvation. In chapter 8 of Matthew, we see when disciples were with Jesus, they were inside, they went inside the sea, and they were in the Galilee, the place Galilee, and they went into the sea, and they came a great storm. And it was almost, they seemed like the boat was going to sink. And they lost hope. They look at that and they started thinking like, what's going to happen? Where is our master now? Where is he? Today our thoughts will be like that. Lord, where are you? In the midst of this much hard times that people were going through. Lord, where are you? Where are you? I can't meet my parents. I can't go out and meet my friends. I can't go to church and worship you. I can't play. I can't sit properly. I feel so alone, Lord. Where are you? I'm going to sink in this world. I'm feeling so alone, Lord. There are people shouting in our hearts like this right now in this time, my dear friends. Look at this. God is saying, if God is the one who asks you to put the boat inside the sea, He is the one He is the one who is going to calm the storm, and He is the one who is going to give the salvation. Amen. Hallelujah. God is the one He is going to touch us. God is the one who is going to take through this. And God is always there for Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego. They, when they went into the fire furnace, He was there in the midst of them. People were people's thoughts were out of mind. Man, come on, we guys have kept only three, right? The one more is coming up there, and he looks like someone who came from God. Come on, He is God. Nowadays, God is helping us in the form of Holy Spirit. He's gonna speak to you. He's gonna help you. He's gonna deal with your roots. Whatever we are going through, I remember this thing when I am studying my bachelor's in theology. We have a psychology class in that, behavioral psychology. I used to give reports to my teacher, and she's very gracious, and she is very lovable and very cute, and she's very elderly woman, and she used to take my assignments, and she used to read everything which I wrote there. And she came to conclusion I was suffering with anxiety issues. And she said, like, Samuel, when I see your past, you going through very tough time. You can't even trust your friends or something like that. And you know, Samuel, our God is very close, and our God will present. You see, someone is saying our God is an omnipotent, and yes, He is very powerful, and He is present everywhere, and He is very close to your heart, and He will help you to come out. My dear friends, I was very anxious guy, you know. I was very anxious guy. I was like little talented guy. I used to play some instruments. I used to preach, or else I have some anxiety issues. Because of this anxiety issues, I am not progressive. My outcome will change, because when I feel anxious about something, about coming 5 minutes, coming half an hour, I have to preach. Coming 15 minutes, I have to preach. I feel anxious inside. This fear is good for certain extent. But the fear of God is good. Fear of having something which is reliable and which is like logical, at least in worldly sense, is okay. But anxiety is a continuously having fear. It's like FRET. This is the word that they use to express this thing in anxiety, in the background of anxiety when we speak. See, when you feel that thing in your life, your progress is going to come down. Many people I see, I can imagine. See, look at this, my dear friends. Look at this. You decided to do something in your life, and okay, let's bring this thing down to our daily life and think about this. See, you have planned to do something. Okay, I decided, having planned for 40 days, I'll complete 30 chapters every day, and I'll complete the Bible reading. Once I'll complete the whole Bible, for the glory of God. Okay, so I decided to do that. But during night when I'm sleeping, the day before when I'm going to start, I feel anxious, very much anxious. If I feel anxious, now I'm not feeling anxious, but I'm saying that, for example, if you feel anxious, how it will result? See, if you feel anxious, like morning 8 o'clock, I have to get up and I have to read a Bible from, oh my goodness, I have to read all Genesis, start from today, and I have to do it. But do you know, when you feel anxious, you will not get sleep properly. You will be waking up every half an hour and saying, it's only half an hour, I have to sleep again. So you sleep. But again, you will wake up and you will say, the time is not at all over. And you waste your energy when you feel anxious. That is what Jesus says in the mountain, Sermon on the Mount. He says, like, don't be anxious. Don't ever be anxious, because God is the one who is taking control of everything. Depend upon Him, because He is the rock. He is the rock, is the firm foundation that you can stand, and you have faith in Him. My dear friends, Jesus is saying more and more. Come on, praise God. We're giving Bible verses and all. Really, praise God. Whatever we have, I wish you could open your Bibles and read this thing and be blessed. For today's meditation, we're going to take a part from Sermon on the Mount. See, Sermon on the Mount can be also called as authoritative message of Messiah. Because Messiah is Jesus, when He spoke in His times, He spoke with authority. He has right to do that, because His way of life and His teachings were going parallel. What do you say, like parallel? Yeah, parallel. They're going parallel. See, every time when people were listening to the people, many times they say, like, see, my dear brother, we used to listen preachings of this person, so and so. He used to preach very well word of God. And when I see his life, I don't feel like he lives in the same way. When some, or else you may be discouraged by someone, some Christian friends around you. They speak more about God. They speak more about God and they share word of God. They sing beautiful songs. They have beautiful melody and they have beautiful voices to do. Praise God. But when you see their lives, they were not, for set an example. But Jesus is not at all like that. I few years back I have posted one quote in my Insta, and it says like this. Jesus never said to follow Christians. Jesus never said follow Christians. He said follow me. See, look at this. There is a lot of variation. See, friends, when we are not setting an example for the world, see, people started looking at us and feeling like Christians will be like this. Christ is also like this. See, this is the truth that we have to come out of. And don't ever imagine that when you think something is true, and you try to, because you imagine it is true, you try to fight for it. See, that is not true. If your standards were not for the God's standards, look at that, look Christ in the Bible and set your example. Lord, you live like this. You prayed a lot. Thank you so much for setting an example. Lord, you loved your people. You loved your disciples. Thank you so much. I'm hearing some noise from back. I think some other device is playing repeatedly. Thank you so much. See, look at this. Look at this. See, this parable I'm going to share is the from childhood, I used to sing this song. What is that? That song name, yesterday when we are talking, this song came in between. It's like, Buddhileni vadu illu kattenu, Buddhileni vadu illu kattenu, Iska meda kattenu, Vanalu vachenu, Varada vachenu, Vanalu vachi, Varada vachenu, Buddhi kaligina vadu illu kattenu, బుద్ధి కలిగిన వాడు ఇల్లు కట్టెను, వానలు వచ్చును వరదలు వచ్చును, కానీ బుద్ధున్న వాడు ఎక్కడ కట్టాడంట, బండ మీద కట్టాను, బండ మీద కట్టాను, వానలు వచ్చును వరద వచ్చును, తన ఇల్లును నిలిచాను అని చెప్తున్నారు. తన ఇల్లు నిలిచిందంట. ఎందుకు నిలిచింది? నీ జీవితాన్ని ఎక్కడ కడుతున్నావు ప్రియమైన స్నేహితుడ, ప్రియమైన స్నేహితురాలు, ఈరోజు ఎక్కడ కడుతున్నావు మన జీవితాన్ని? మనం ఎక్కడ చూస్తున్నాం మనం మన పరిస్థితుల్లో? వేర్ ఆర్ వి వాచింగ్ టు? ఆర్ వి వాచింగ్ టువర్డ్స్ క్రైస్ట్ ఇన్ ఎ వే దట్ క్రైస్ట్ ఈస్ ద ఫర్మ్ ఫౌండేషన్ ఫర్ అవర్ లైఫ్? ఆర్ ఎల్స్ ఆర్ యూ గివింగ్ మోర్ importance to the things that you are doing daily in back at home? Or else are you giving more importance some other things, your gadgets, some other people in your life, and spending a lot of the time? I regret saying this to the Christian friends. You guys, many of the people from our Christian friends at the young ages like me and like you, were wasting times spending all the night talking with people in the call, in phones. My dear friends, you don't even talk to God for 10 to 20 minutes, but you waste a lot of time speaking to them. Look at that. Look at that. Oh, what language is that? It's in Telugu. Sorry, I'm really sorry. It came because a lot of people here understand Telugu, and they do understand Hindi also, but I don't know properly to say that. My mother tongue is Telugu. So, see, look at that. Look at this example and understand. We understand what the song is saying actually, because people were there. The song says there was an foolish man who had built his house on the sand as a basement. He used the sand. This is where does this come from? It is a parable from the Mount, Sermon on the Mount, where Jesus speaks in Matthew chapter 7, 24 to 27. And Luke chapter 6, 46 to 49, he speaks about this parable. This parable speaks about how we have to depend, how wise we have to be. Being wise, what did Bible calls being wise? It's directly speaking there, indirectly giving. Jesus is giving an authoritative speech to the people there. My dear friends, the key verse here is, the key verse in here, Matthew chapter 7, chapter 24 to 27. Brother, if you can display that. Okay, thank you so much. Thank you so much. Matthew chapter 7, 24 to 27. See, this is the text that we have took here, and I really like to read it for us. See, my dear friends, look to this. I want to read Bible because, see, even if I speak, if the words from human can impact us, think about the word of God, which we read every day, which we have today in our hands. We have to read it, really. I really love reading Bible. So we will read together, and really we look to the God. See, look at this. Everyone, then one who hears these words of mine, does them will be like a wise man who built his house on the rock. And rain fell, and the flood came. The winds blow and beat on the house, but it did not fall, because it had been founded on the rock. And everyone who hears these words of mine and does not do them will be like a foolish man who built his house on sand. And rain fell, the floods came, and wind blowed and beat against the house, and it fell. And the great was the fall of it. Look at that. Look at that. Look at that. Look at that. I see here is one important word. See, look at this here. It says, the wind blowed and beat against the house, both for wise and for foolish people. Both house were hurt, or else they got damaged, or else this wind is trying to damage both of their houses. But look to this, my dear friends. Even we in our lives as a Christians, now suffering with the all the world. Why? Because God's judgment is upon us also. We are one part. We are humanity. We are in one part. We are brothers from each and everyone. Look at this thing and understand it. Even winds come in our life. If Christ is there in your boat, there is no guarantee that storms will not come. But if Christ is there, He is the one who is going to bring you out of the storm. Let's all believe. Whoever believes, say amen. I really like to hear that. Really, amen. Hallelujah. Really, it's a good thing. My dear friends, the key verse here is verse 24. Hearing the word and putting them in practice is the key of this parable. What is that? Hearing the word and putting it in practice. You say many people listen to the word of God. I do listen more lot of sermons. But is it that I am keeping it in my life? Am I applying it in my life? Or else am I doing the great things for God, at least by submitting and asking Him, Lord, use me in the mighty way. Lord, I submit myself. I'm not worthy to do all these things. But Lord, I ask you, I beg you a pardon. Please use me. Please, I want to do your will. I want to trust you. People, are you willing to say this today? Are you willing to say this to people and say to God, say that, Lord, I believe in you. I want to trust you more, deeper into your word. I want to go and I want to understand your wisdom that you have. The wisdom that we have today should be coming from God. My dear friends, James chapter 1 verse 22, it says, James chapter 1 verse 22 says to be the doers of the word. The word of God is every time coming to us. Are we doing? Are we following? Or do you have Christ as a firm foundation? If you're a rock where you build your life called building, the life that was you are building, or is it building? Are you building it on the sand where the world is suffering, where you can see now in the circumstances of COVID-19, where the firm foundations of this world were shaken, all the presidents of the great countries were suffering, people were coming out and singing songs and praising God now. Why? Because they can't do anything. Hope is gone. No, hope is only in the God Almighty who created the universes. Amen. Hallelujah. So let's look to Him now. Where are we standing? Where are we standing? Where am I standing? Where am I standing now? Where is my faith? Where is my faith? Am I looking to Him? First Corinthians. See, my dear friends, this Sermon on Mountain ends with people thinking that how in the world this man called Jesus of Nazareth is preaching with authority. And He's saying this many mighty things because He is Messiah, because He is Son of God, because He is the one who sent by God as a gift for ransom for us, and by His wounds we are healed. Look at this. How we can't even imagine. We can't even imagine. The people who like us, who can't give a beggar a 100 rupees note from our purse. For God is sending His own Son and giving His life for us as ransom, and by His wounds we are healed. And see, look at this, all these things. Come on, my dear friends. See, reflect on this and decide where we are standing today. Do we have the rock of our salvation under us, or else are we standing on the firm that was firm? People were thinking what firm foundation they have that was waiting today, and we can look it with our own eyes. We can experience with our readings. We can experience with our daily news feeds. We can experience these things right now. My dear friend, I am requesting you, experience Christ in your life. Experience the firm foundation, the rock of our salvation, the reliability on Christ, the faith that brought us the hope for eternity, and the faith that was shown by love. Amen. In 1 Corinthians chapter 3 verse 11, it says the foundation is only Jesus. He is the only way to go. And when it goes to 1 Corinthians 13, chapter 13, says about faith, hope, among them the love is great. Why? Because love, God is love, sorry. Standard we watch in this world, the standards were with the creator only. See, when God is creating universe, where is righteousness come to him? Because he is the measure of righteousness. You can't measure God with the righteousness. He is the perfect. His perfections were almost like you can't nullify. We can't compare with our righteousness. We can't think about God with our own wisdom. See, it's all about faith now. Faith has reason in it. Christ had came to our world. Are you willing to accept that knowledge? Are you willing to respond? This is what we have three elements in the faith. So let's look to the Lord and ask him, Lord, today I want that rock of salvation. I want that eternal life. No, Lord, even if a small thing happened today, I may die. But you are saying that I may have no condemnation, no punishment after this life. Even if I sleep or else awake, you are saying you will give a salvation through Christ. I really praise God for this. I really praise God for this. Can you all read this and end this section? Philippians chapter 1 verse 21. See, if you understand this sermon, if we understand this word of God right now where we meditated, I think this will help us to understand more and more, and it will result in saying this sentence. This sentence, really. Philippians, Ephesians. Yeah. See, we can clearly speak this. Yes, Ephesians, Philippians, yes. Chapter 1, verse 21. My dear friends, if you really understand this message, you are going to say this word from the bottom of your heart, and from the bottom of your heart, you are saying, the salvation, my rock, my Savior, Jesus Christ, is a firm foundation. Even if this world exists or not exists, my God is the one who put me here. He has greater plans for me. Today, when I'm about to post some birthday wishes, and God is giving a nice idea like, Lord, how can I express my sister is celebrating a birthday, and how can I express to her that you loves you more and more? And that God is speaking to me through the word of God, John chapter 3 verse 16. God so loved the world. You see, in the world, your sister is also there. I loved her so much. So look to her now and imagine how much I love and I give my son. I just tagged it and I wrote this thing. If the words were enough to describe you, your worth, Christ could not have come down and died for you. Look at this. See, I'm saying to you, if words can describe you, people were putting you down and asking, you are waste, you can't do this thing. They're putting you down. They're making you to feel depressed all the time. You are with the gadgets, or else all the time you are with the Bible. They're keeping you disgraced. You will not get anything. If you read chapters of Bible, they discourage you. Even if you pray, there is nothing going to happen. They discourage you. But my dear friends, God is saying, God so loved you. And he had given his son. And that son had been a firm foundation for us of faith. And we will depend upon him. I will depend upon him. And we could say this Bible verse with a firm foundation that we have. With the strength and energy that God had given us. With the trust and the things that he had cooperating, he's sustaining us. We can say this word. First Philippians chapter 1 verses 21. It says, for me to live is Christ. And to die is gain. Yes. Yes, my dear friends. For me, to live is Christ. And to die is gain. Why? Because in this world, I have a lot of sorrow. I have a lot of things to think. A lot of things I have to go through. I have to manage my food, shelter, all these things. I have to manage my electricity, my house. I have to manage my bikes, or else whatever I love in this world, I have to manage. Even if you love your children, you have to manage. You have to give them care. You have to take care of everything. And all these things were burdening. And Christ is saying, give me your burdens. I'll give you peace. Come on, my dear friends. Come on. Are you going to say this? See, in 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 10, it says, sorrowful, yet always rejoicing. Sorrowful, but always rejoicing. If you have Christ in your life, and if you have Christ like rock, the salvation, the firm foundation, even if world got destroyed, even if you die today, you're going to have salvation. My dear friends, once again, I'm going to remember, make you think about, reflect on this. If you die in the present second, I die here in the present second, my dad, after 3 days, even if he loves me so much, even if he loves me so much, he can't, after 3 days, he can't call me, he can't call me back like, Sam, he says, this body, take this body, it is stinking. See how fragile the foundations of this world. My dear friend, God is saying he's going to give you eternal life. I really ask you, I really please you, I really, what do you say, like, I really ask you to reflect on this. Are we standing where? Are we standing on something else other than Christ? Someday it's going to fall down, because someday rain is going to come. Someday the flood is going to come. Someday the wind is going to hit your life. And where are we now? Do we have the firm foundation? He is the rock under my feet. Amen. He is the rock under my feet. Shall we look to the Lord in prayer? And I really blessed by this sermon. God spoke to me, and I wish I could share this to many people. I like to share this in YouTube also, if possible. And really praise God for this special moment that God had given us. Shall we look to the Lord in prayer? Father, thank you so much. Thank you so much. Lord, you're saying such a beautiful word. If I told you to take your boat and go inside the sea, see, I am the God who's gonna give you wisdom, knowledge, everything. He's gonna help you to come out. If that sea is suffering, if the sea has a storm in it, don't be afraid. Have a little faith. Even if you have little faith, I am there present with you. Have the faith, and I will make you to come out of that. My dear friends, God is going to help us to come out of this depressed spirit. God is going to help us to understand who is the firm foundation of this world. God is going to help us to depend upon Him and worship Him with all we have, all the strength, with all the might we have, all the abilities, all the talents we have, all the things that we have. We're gonna worship Him so, because He is worthy. He is listening our prayers. And God is speaking. If you are a man who's depending upon God, He is the Lord who carried the Israelites come out of that Egypt. He is God who raised the Jesus of Nazareth from the dead. He is God who sustained His people till today in the history. And He is going to help you. He is going to take you out of the situations what we are going through. Even if the death comes into this flesh, He is going to help you to come out. And you're going to have eternal life when Christ is our firm foundation and the rock of our salvation. Amen. God may bless you each and everyone. In the name of Jesus, I pray, Lord. Amen. Thank you for so much for being with us, Lord. Thank you so much. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord, each and everyone, whoever are there in the online. I am really blessed sharing this word. Really, the Spirit of God is moving. I really hope this time will become a revival in our churches. All the youth, all the people who are really starving for the Word of God in the live sections, and who are really starving to listen to the Word of God and express how they're feeling. And really, it's going to bring a revival in church, and God will really mightily move when our churches were going to open. I hope the day will come when people will sit, even if the church is going to start before 5 minutes, they'll come and sit there, and the time they will spend in the songs, they will not go out after the songs got over. They want to listen to the Word of God, and they will not go after the Word of God over. They will want to give up the offering time, and they're going to stay there, and they're going to stay and until the praise, until the blessing was given, they will stay there and praise Him, and they glorify Him for the revival that come in this time. This quarantine is the time that God is going to bless us more and more. We have hope. God bless us. Really, I'm blessed, bro. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. God is really moving. Praise Lord. I request everyone to join the prayers. Don't be shy and come to pray and really praise God, giving Him worthy. You always have to give thanks. I really thank God for this time. I am really blessed to be in this online service, and I really thank and admire people who are doing this ministry, and it will be a great blessing in the coming days too. In the name of Jesus, I really greet you. Thank you so much. Praise Lord.